والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
Dear brothers, there is no case in the world that carried really total injustice in history and total corruption of the truth like the Palestinian situation, where politics, greed of economy, human greed, and also religion was used as a buffer or as a banner and abused, like this, the situation of Palestine. So that's the problem. So we're going to pass through a little bit, if I bore you, with a little bit of historical data. And we'll talk about some religious misconceptions, in addition to the Islamic point of view in the matter, and of course the international point of view of the matter, which is supposed to be very objective. Number one, all of us know that Islam does not teach any kind of racism. We don't hate any individual because he's that individual. As an example, we don't hate the Jews, or we call them by any names because they are Jews. We learn to be very objective. And the Quran is full of ayahs of that. God Almighty says in the Quran, those who believed among the Jews and the Christians and among As-Sabi'a, the people who used to worship Jupiter, others, and even among those idol worshippers, those who believe, they are accepted by God. So always it's an open-minded system. That's rule number one in Islam. Because our Prophet, may peace be upon him, like all the prophets of God, was sent with a very clear and sympathetic message to the whole world. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We haven't sent you indeed except as a mercy to the worlds. Notice the word. It says to the worlds. The words that we know are the words of the human and the genies. And the words we don't know yet, that we might discover in the future. Maybe other galaxies, other plantations, also other creatures living with us. Maybe, and I'm sure that we're going to discover tomorrow or after tomorrow, that the ants are nations by themselves, the bees are nations by themselves, sort animals that we consider them are, don't have minds, they do have minds of their own, and they are worshipping God Almighty. So every prophet was sent as that, and especially Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him. So that means every Muslim is supposed to be open-hearted, open-minded toward the whole world. We love everything around us. We want to save everything around us. We are told by a saying of the Prophet, may peace be upon him, if one mountain is oppressing another mountain, imagine we're talking about nonsensible things. God Almighty in the day of judgment is going to overwhelm the obsessor, the oppressor. And the Prophet ﷺ said, any person who's injusted upon, even if he was a kafir, God Almighty will give him victory. Always the oppressed, God Almighty will stand with them. If not in this life that we live, because this life sometimes is short, and we witnessed many injustices happened in this life, but God Almighty name is Al-Hadil, one of the names, He's the just. God Almighty is the just, He's fair. So that's why He set a court in the last day. In the day of judgment, there is a judgment day that even the sheep with horns that dodged into a sheep without horns, God Almighty will recreate them again and will give the ones without horns, horns to revenge. So imagine to that small matters, it's important. So let's pass by the story of Jerusalem and Palestine. Jerusalem itself, it's the essence of the matter, Palestine is surrounding Jerusalem. It's called in the Quran, it's called in the Hadith, Baytul Maqdis, the house of holiness. Baytul Maqdis. The Arabs now call it Al-Quds. Again, it means the holiness. These are just to start the names. There is a whole surah in the Quran called Suratul Isra. What is Suratul Isra? Allah Almighty says in Suratul Isra, Subhana الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله. Glorified is your Lord, the one who at night he gave the Prophet Muhammad, be peace be upon him, the ability to travel in one night to Jerusalem from the Masjid al-Haram, the sacred mosque, to the further mosque, which is called Al-Aqsa. And the historians or the Arabic linguistic people, they said the name Al-Aqsa is coming from many meanings. One of them, it is far from Mecca, so it's farther away. One of them is Al-Aqsa, that it is the outmost, highest. So these are among the names of Al-Aqsa. So God Almighty, in this ayah, if you recall, it was revealed while the Prophet ﷺ was in Mecca. That time, the grand mosque, the sacred mosque, was not a mosque yet. It was ruled by the Quraysh's, the idol worshippers. It was full of 360 idols around the Kaaba. So God Almighty here, there is a prophecy in this surah, that this is a masjid and that one is a masjid. So God Almighty gave you as a fast trip at night from this masjid to that masjid, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made blessings around its areas. That's the start. There we see. Of course, Al-Aqsa or Jerusalem was mentioned in many chapters in the Quran, in many surahs, and among them, In Surah Al-Anbiya, as you can see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called that land the blessed land in many verses, as we can see in 71, 81, 105 in Surah Al-Anbiya. Allah is calling that area the blessed land. التي باركنا فيها الأرض. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. This is why He chooses certain times, as we can see, and call them holy, like Ramadan, like Hajj, like Ashura. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls certain places holy or blessed, like Mecca, Medina, Jerusalem. We know these are the only three holy places for the Muslims. Jerusalem itself, it's mentioned again in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Prophet Talut, that idkhul al-ard al-muqaddasa. Here is called muqaddasa, not only mubaraka. Mubaraka means blessed. Muqaddasa means holy. So we consider the whole land of Palestine is a holy land, because they're not entering only Jerusalem, around Jerusalem. So it's called al-muqaddasa. And Jerusalem and Palestine is considered, as all of you know, holy by the Jews, Christians, and Muslims together. In Surah An-Nur 36, and in Nahl 17, again in Surah Qaf, ayah number 41, many of the mentioning of the holiness of this land of Jerusalem and around it. All of us recite Surah At-Tin. It's a short surah, everybody knows. Allah says, وَالتِّينِ وَالزَّيْتُونِ وَطُورِ سِنِينَ وَهَذَا الْبَلَدِ الْأَمِينَ. And this is the same prophecy which is mentioned again in the book of creation, in the Bible, where God Almighty said, the Lord came from the Mount of Seir and raised from the Mount of Sinai. I'm sorry, the Lord came from the Mount of Sinai and raised from the Mount of Seir and shined and glorified from the Mount of Paran. Again, the Bible is mentioning the three spots of the last three great prophets of God Almighty are coming from. In Sinai, the Mount of Sinai, where Prophet Moses, alayhi salam, Moses, may peace be upon him, received his first revelation, as we know the surah, that he saw certain light. He thought he would take some charcoal for his family, but he found the tree lighted without any fire. And God Almighty spoke to him. That's if you want to review in Surah Taha, the beginning of Surah Taha, the mentioning of the revelation of Musa alayhi salam. Isa alayhi salam, as we know, he was born miraculously in Surah Maryam. But at the age of 30, he received his first revelation in the Mount of Olive, and it's called Seir in Jerusalem. And Allah in Surah At-Teen ended by swearing by وَهَذَا الْبَلَدِ الْأَمِينِ, this trustworthy city, which is Mecca. And it's called in the Bible the Mount of Paran, or the Mount of Kedar, or the land of Kedar. So we can see, number one, the unity among the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there is no hatred. Many people think because we love our Prophet Muhammad, they can attack Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam to bother us. They think for revenge will attack Jesus. They think for revenge will attack David or Solomon. I saw with my own eyes in Amman, Jordan, a crazy woman, Palestinian, fled her home. But she was crazy after the flee. So in the market, she cursed David, alayhi salam. She was captured by the Jordanian police. I want the whole world to witness this. Because she attacked the Prophet of Allah. We don't hate even our aggressors, our oppressors. When they are injusted upon us, we are not allowed to attack or to mention by any kind of degradatory words or anything about prophets of God Almighty. It's considered invalid in our religion. It might lead the person to be a kafir. So I cannot say Dawood alayhi salam, except I say alayhi salam. And he's considered, they call it David Star. They think we hate David Star. I hate what they do, but I don't hate David alayhi salam. So that's the origin of the matter. We know that the word Jerusalem itself can carry many meanings, but let me pass again by the hadith of Rasulullah wasallam. So to know the holiness again of Jerusalem. When Rasulullah wasallam said in the hadith, لا تشد الرحال, that no one can travel for religious purposes except to three spots. The only places that you can do pilgrim to, or at least you can make a travel for religious purpose and you get reward for it. He said, Al-Masjid al-Haram wa Masjid hada wa Al-Masjid al-Aqsa. The Grand Mosque, the Masjid of the Prophet والسلام, and Al-Masjid al-Aqsa. This is in Bukhari. In An-Nisa'i there is a hadith that Rasulullah said that Solomon, they call him Solomon in English, in the Bible, we call him Sulaiman alayhi salam, the son of David, son of Dawood, alayhim as-salam, son and father, made a dua after he finished building the temple. He made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Ya Allah, I want you to reward those who come to this masjid. So he's granted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that no one goes into Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa intending only to pray. Yani its purpose is not for commercial reasons. As you know, some Hajj in Arabia, they have a joke. They say Hajj and Bi'a Subah. You know, they make Hajj and at the same time they sell. So the purpose or the target in the heart is mixed. Am I going there for merchandising or am I going there for pilgrimage? But here the hadith says about Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, no one intends to go to Jerusalem to pray in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa only to, for that intention. He will be getting out of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa like the day he was born. Totally sinless. Totally sinless. This hadith in Nasa'i. There is another hadith that by Tahawi and corrected by Al-Albani. I don't know if you, because I'm trying to make some summarization here. You know, Sheikh Muhammad Nasr al-Din Al-Albani is one of famous writers in this century that followed the hadith to make authentications of the hadith. So this is, hadith is correct, and it says that the Prophet ﷺ said, وَلَنِعْمَ الْمُصَلَّى هُوَ, the best of places of salah is Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. It is better than the whole dunya. خَيْرٌ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا جَمِيعًا. So these are the the holiness of Al-Aqsa in the hearts of the Muslims. And we know in Surah Al-Isra and the story of Isra, you know, story of trip to Jerusalem, then from there is the ascension to heaven, that all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came down to Jerusalem by the will of Allah, and all of them prayed together and were led by Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Then he stood from the rock. You know, today we have the dome of the rock, you know, the golden dome. From the dome of the rock, he stood there alayhi salatu wasalam on that rock, and he was ascended to heaven to pass through the seven skies. That's maybe another subject we can talk about later, inshallah. This is to prove, number one, the leadership of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the last of the prophets, the seal of the prophets, and the imam of the prophets, alayhi salam jami'a. And to prove again, the unity of all the prophets, all of them came to that message, to know that your Lord is one Lord. Know, Israel, that your Lord is one Lord. All of them came with that message. So this is the holiness of Jerusalem, which is mentioned in Islam. We know, if I follow the traces of the Bible, because once I was in a discussion with some Jews on the land of Palestine, and they said clearly, there is nothing called Palestine. Nothing is called Palestine. And this is what the brainwashing is happening today. The control of the media in the world, they show us, and as I mentioned in the very beginning, as we said in those myths, we ask you some myth questions, that the Arabs came upon the Jews and occupied the land. The Arabs never interfaced with the Jews in Jerusalem, never. Because the Jews were not existing when the Arabs came, or the Muslims came this, during the days of Umar ibn al-Khattab to Jerusalem. Anyhow, there were no Jews at all. Matter of fact, the last statistic I was reading, in the year 1880, call it DC, AC, 1880, only 5 Jews lived in Jerusalem. 5 Jews. But they came with the occupiers in 1917, when the British occupied Jerusalem, that they brought from Europe. The migrations. So let me go back a little bit in history. The book of creation, in chapter 12, from the verse 1, this is the first time we hear about Jerusalem and the land of Canaan. Notice the word. The land of Canaan, where God Almighty is telling Abraham, may peace be upon him, and his nephew Lot, that traveled from Babel. Because those people we give up with, they are disbelievers. As you know the story of Abraham, he was suffering, he worked with his people, they put him on fire, and suffered a lot. So the book of creation, the first book of the Bible, talked about the land of Canaan. And God Almighty is telling him, go to that land where you'll find a just or a fair king. He will receive you there. So it's mentioned here, and it says that Malki Sadiq is a good person of God. He was the leader of Jerusalem. That means, number one, that Jerusalem, the word Jerusalem or Jerusalem, existed before Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this is 4,000 before Christ. 4,000 years before Christ, may peace be upon him. So this is important piece of history. So nobody can say that the Jews established Jerusalem, because they call it Orshalim today in Hebrew. Matter of fact, historically, the word is Yuru Salem. Salem is either from Salam, peace, or Salem, one of their kings, according to the historians. And it was a temple for the Canaanites there. And Malki Sadiq was a person who unified God. So they were monotheistic religion. The Canaanites at that time were monotheistic. As you know, in history, a religion comes, people continue, then it decays. As you know, the sons of Noah alayhi salam, many of them were Muslims that time, but their grandsons were not Muslims. Because they start to worship certain idols, they have start to have some certain saints. And this is how religion can decay, if nobody goes to the root. So that's the story of Jerusalem or Jerusalem. It's mentioned in the book of creation again, the land of Yebus. Yebuses, the people are called Yebuses or Canaanites, were coming from the Arabian Peninsula. And Canaan is one of the descendants of Ham. Ham is a son of Noah. We know Noah, may peace be upon him. I'm using the Bible now. Noah, may peace be upon him, had Sam and Japheth and Ham are his sons. So that's the story in the beginning. In the book of creation again, in 14:17, it says that Abraham was received by Melchizedek, who gave him bread and wine. He received him, and he was a nice host to Abraham, may peace be upon him. The word Palestine, as I mentioned, was mentioned since that day. So nobody today can claim that the Palestinians are the ones who are temporary, the ones who came later. They were before the word Israel appears. Because we'll find out later from the word Israel where it's coming from. The word Judah, where it appeared. Historically, the Palestinians were ahead. The Canaanites were ahead. I know now thousands of Palestinians today are called Muhammad Abdullah Canaan. Their original is Canaan. That means 5,000 years before Christ. So they existed there. The creation 33, it mentions Jerusalem, and it says that Jacob, may peace be upon him, also there, and he rented a place, that Jacob rented a place for him to have a land there to farm. We know in history again, the book of Genesis talked that when Sarah, may peace be upon her, the wife of Abraham, died, Abraham, may peace be upon him, went to one Canaani, one Palestinian, and rented from him a piece of land. He said, I want to bury my wife. And after 2 years, you can take your land again, because it's a rental, it's not bought. So he rented a burial place for his wife. But the Palestinian was very nice, and he saw Abraham, may peace be upon him, as a man of God. He told him, the land is yours. So when Abraham died, he was buried next to his wife. And also when Isaac buried his wife, he buried his wife next to his parents. Then when Isaac, may peace be upon him, you know Isaac is the son of Abraham, the second son of Abraham after Ishmael, also died, he was buried there. So now we have four tombs next to each other. Then when Jacob lived in Egypt with his sons, 12 sons of his, at the end of his life asked to come back to Palestine, and he buried his wife Rachel. Maybe you hear the word Rachel or Rahel. She's buried there. Then he was buried there. All of this today in a city called Al-Khalil. In English they call it Hebron. The Jews proved their stigma. Hebron was never called Hebron. It was called Al-Khalil. Al-Khalil, you know, who knows what? What is Al-Khalil? From where? Who's Al-Khalil? Ibrahim, yes. Where is the rewards? Jazakallah khair. Brother Yusuf. Tfaddal. Somebody is awake. No, all of you are awake, inshallah. Ibrahim Al-Khalil, which means the close friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's the name of the city. We'll find 6 graves are there. Today the Israelis, since 1967, they occupied that land. And though it's 100% Muslims, even no Christians are in that city. But the Israelis destroyed all the buildings around the mosque, and they confiscated the mosque. They allowed the Muslims only to musalla, to pray. But they keep the graves for themselves because they feel that Abraham and Sarah and Isaac and Jacob are related to them, are not related to the Muslims. The Muslims are banned from visiting the graves of all of those prophets. May peace be upon them. That's what's happening today. So that's about Jerusalem and a little bit about the history. All of us know that Abraham had 2 sons. Ishmael is firstborn, then Isaac. From Isaac, his second son, Jacob, is considered the father of the Israelis. This is where the first time you hear the word Israel appears. And miserably to say, really, that the word Israel appeared, maybe you know this, in a very shameful way. A very shameful way. Where it says that God Almighty, this is where, this is in Genesis again, in Genesis 32:28. You can check it for your own. It says that God Almighty came down to earth and he appeared before Jacob and he intimidated him. They start to wrestle. So they were wrestling together from the early morning until almost sunset. And Jacob was mighty and strong and he was overwhelming God. Then it says again in Genesis in 32:28 that Jacob gave God a hard butt between his thighs. Imagine. This term for sure, astaghfirullah al-azim, is made up. We know that for sure. Where now? It is in the Bible, in the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis. And the people who follow the Bible, whether Jews they call it Torah, or the Christians who call it the Old Testament, they say, Jacob beat God. Jacob held God between his thighs. Excuse me, he was holding his what? Yeah, imagine the private parts. And it says here, God said, let me go. Leave me alone. Take your hands away. Take your hands away. He said, no. Until you bless me. Look at the two mistakes now. That means Jacob knows that this is God. This, my brothers and sisters, shows you or explains to you why what's happening is happening today. Because the Jews have no respect even to God. And the Christians who follow them, the Zionist Christians, they have the same feeling. If God can be overwhelmed, and God is beaten. Though the Jews are monotheistic, not like the Christians who are, they believe in Trinity. But what God they believe in? They believe in God that they own, not God that owns them. So here it says, God said to him, okay, I'm going to bless you. What is your name? He said, my name is Jacob. He said, no, from today, your name is not Jacob. Your name is Israel. Today shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men has prevailed. Because you beat me. Beat me, so you are Israel. This is a big lie. You know why? Because the word Israel in Hebrew means Abdullah. It cannot be. Because you beat me, I call you Abdullah. It cannot be. Logically, it cannot be. But we believe he was called Israel because as Israel, like in Hebrew, similar to the Arabic, from the word Asir. Asir means captive or a slave. Asirullah, Asir El. That's the meaning of the word Israel. But imagine the big lie that now the Jews are saying, and the big lie that they are manipulating the religion by saying that Israel has overwhelmed God. This is the first time in the book of Genesis that you can see the word Israel appears. That means Abraham came into the kingdom of the Palestinians. Isaac lived under the kingdom of the Palestinians. Israel himself, Jacob, may peace be upon him, lived under the kingdom of the Palestinians. Till now, there is no Jewish rule. And though it's called Israel or the prince of power, whatever, but there is no Jewish rule till now. So this is important part of the history here.
Thank you.
know that Jacob, during his time, historically, was total poverty. They lived in isolated land with his sons. They were only like Bedouin. They have camels and sheep. And they were sending their camels and sheep in Egypt to buy or sell. That's if you follow the story in the Bible, it clearly says that. You know the story of Joseph, I want to stand with it, alayhi salam. But they have a total surah called Yusuf in the Quran. You can read it, you can appreciate it. It is better than what the Bible says of attacks. The story of Yusuf, you learn from it many administrative and managerial things from Yusuf, and also you learn from it the peaceful way and the forgiveness of Yusuf to his brothers. But we know at the end that Yusuf asked his father and his brothers, the 12 brothers, to come to Egypt. They lived in Egypt afterward until the days of Musa alayhi salam. So, but again, what I'm leading to, Jacob had 12 sons. These are the 12 tribes of the Israelis. So we say the Israelites means 12 sons of Jacob alayhi salam. Then Musa appears. We know the story of Musa, Moses, may peace be upon him. When he came to the Pharaoh, who was called Ramses II, we know the story. And this has happened in the year of 1350 before Christ. So now Moses, 1350 years before Christ, alayhi salam. Then he took his people out by the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know he crossed the sea. But they stayed 40 years in diaspora, in a tea. Because they were not obedient to Allah. They are not following Moses. They saw the miracles with their own eyes. They saw the 7 miracles performed by Musa alayhi salam in front of the Pharaoh. And they crossed the sea. They saw the sea split. But still, as soon as they crossed, they said, Musa, please can you make us a god like those? They want a god to worship. When Moses, may peace be upon him, went to meet the Lord in the Mount of Sinai, he came back and he found them worshipping a cow they made. Man-made cow in gold. They worshipped the cow, and they said. And they saw all of this witness. But as Moses called them, you are stiff necks. Stiff necks. Jesus, may peace be upon him. Again, you can read in the New Testament. He called them, you are stiff necks. You are vampires. Again, because they see the signs very clear, and they still deny, and they still disobey because of love of self. From here, we can find another word appears. The word Yahud. From where the word Jews came, or Yehuda, or Judah. Because one of the sons of Jacob was named Yehuda, or Judah. This is where I can say the word Israelis, from Israel, Jacob. Yehuda is one of the sons. Later on, the word Yehud came to gather all. But it's not really scientific. So when we say Jews or Yehuda, means from Yehud. As we said, Israel is from this word, and Jews, the word Jews from that word. We know that after the tea, they stayed there for 40 years, according to the Bible again. Joshua, if you read the book of Joshua, it mentions before now, before we talk about David. He was the first prophet of the Jews, who was the cousin of Moses, may peace be upon him. He was entering Palestine, but not to Jerusalem. He entered Jericho. And if you read the book of Isaiah, it's very, very nasty verses of what the Jews did in Jericho. It says, do not live anything alive. Kill every living creature. The human, the animals, the donkeys, the dogs, the cows, the sheep, don't let anything alive. And that shows us, my brothers, of those who follow the politics, why in Oslo agreement, the Israelis were willing very fast to give up 2 towns only. 2 cities, who knows them? In Oslo agreement between Yasser Arafat of the PLO, and that time was Isaac Rabin, the Prime Minister of Israel, and Shimon Peres was the Foreign Minister. The treaty itself is called 2 towns first.
Huh?
Gaza is right, correct? Gaza is one. The other one. Yes, Gaza. They want to get rid of Gaza because Gaza is difficult. Isaac Rabin, he said once, I wish I can wake up from my sleep one day and I find Gaza was swallowed by the sea. I don't want to see Gaza. They are stiff people. They are resisting. And the other town was Jericho. Jericho. You call it Jericho. Ariha in Arabic. This is why in Oslo it was called Jericho, Gaza first. Take them. We don't want them. And Jericho was the only town under the Israeli occupation since 1967 until 1991. Nothing happened in it. Because the Israelis, when they occupied Palestine, they moved the occupied areas into New York. As you know, the American grants are by billions every year. Grants, not loans. Grants. So if you go out there and you can compare or contrast between, as an example, Ramallah and Tel Aviv, it's a total cultural shock. It's a very, very difficult land. So again, buildings and high risings and things, except Jericho, because they said in Isaiah, condemned is the one who used one nail to nail one nail in Jericho. So again, you can find the racism is there, the hatred is there. Though historically, it was not proven. Historically, it was not proven that Joshua did this. Joshua was a prophet of God. But again, the Bible is inserted with minds. Inserted with things to explode later on. Inserted with hatred. Inserted with racism. And the problem now that the Christians who are really following Jesus Christ, may peace be upon him, and he was known man of peace, they have to believe in the Old Testament, which is manipulated and played with by the Jews. So it drives them to that goal. This is why they are today. You can see the United States is like captive. The United States is like captives in the hand of the Jews. Because the United States is ruled mostly by born again and by those Zionist Christians and those who want to follow the Old Testament like the New Testament. And the Catholics who are opposing the Jews, and now they are weakened. Throughout history, the Vatican and the Catholic are losing grounds to the Protestant. That's not our subject, but that's reality where we find Zionism is earning grounds on. Anyhow, the Bible mentions that the Israelis entered into Jerusalem in the year 1049 before Christ. And the story of David killing Goliath there. And he established his kingdom. Then Solomon came after David, may peace be upon them all. And he finished the temple of God Almighty. The books there talks about worshiping God, and they were lining up together in a line like the Muslims, and the imam ahead praises the Lord and the people behind him says Ameen. Ameen, like we recite Al-Fatiha and we say Ameen at the end of it. Then of course, as we mentioned, and in the test mashallah you passed, that David and Solomon ruled for all together 70 years. That's the only time they ruled Jerusalem. Because after that they were separated. The sons of Solomon were fighting with each other. Some in a place they call it Judea, and the other place they call Samira. Samira people are a new cult of the Jews, and they are still alive today. They call Nablus, Samira is the Holy Land. And the Judea people, they say Jerusalem is the Holy Land. And they were fighting with each other for a few years, until they were destroyed by a king called Sinharib. Sinharib came from Ashur, from Iraq. Sinharib came and destroyed them. Then a king called Bukhtnasar or Nebuchadnezzar, that's the name in Ashuri language, from Babel, came and finished the temple, destroyed it totally, killed most of the Jews, and held the rest with them, thousands of people of the Jews, in the Babylonian captivity. My brothers, you can read history and future. This is why you know that the operation the Americans did in Iraq is called Babel. Why? Revenge. You come 2,000 years later to revenge from Iraqis because one of their kings in the past killed the Jews. They call it Babel. And what happened in Iraq? 1.5 million are killed. Oil was totally digged to the Americans. All the historian things, historical sites in Iraq were destroyed and they were smuggled outside. Iraq was a wealthy country until 2003. Now today the Iraqis are on the verge of total poverty. And they are in poverty. You can see them, the Iraqis, poor people in Jordan, in Syria, in Egypt. In Europe, many countries hosted them now because they are totally poor. Who controls their wealth, their petroleum? The Americans. This is why Mr. Bush received a shoe. And he deserves more. Again, Babel, remember, because again the American administration with George Bush, 7 people in this office were Jews. I'm not saying this out of my mind. Yeah, I say maybe they are Zionists, they are Jews. They never forget history or made their own made history. They never forget. I'm sorry if I'm taking you a little bit past. Of course, it's proven later on that the Romans, when they came, King Titus, 70 years after Christ, destroyed the temple, kicked all the Jews again from Jerusalem. After him came King Hadrian, who was known that he took any left ruins from the temple even to Rome to destroy it so the Jews cannot claim it anymore. This is why the Jews, since 1967, they occupied Jerusalem. They couldn't find a single pole, a single nail built by David or Solomon, may peace be upon them. No signs. What they did now, underneath Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, they digged about hundreds of tunnels and they built their own temples underneath, in order for them to wish that with those tunnels, one day the whole Masjid Al-Aqsa will collapse. And there is a big warning by the UNESCO that the Masjid Al-Aqsa at any moment, they won't be surprised if it collapses. It's happening today. Okay, as we said, again, I'm talking about history. Islam came, or Jesus, may peace be upon him, was born since the reign of King Herod of Jerusalem. Then Islam came on. Surah Al-Isra came on, as we mentioned, that the Prophet ﷺ, during his life in Mecca, came to Jerusalem, then ascended to heaven to connect the Muslims with Jerusalem. In the year 636 after Christ, Umar ibn al-Khattab came to Jerusalem and they made a treaty because they were surrounding Jerusalem. Umar ibn al-Khattab made a treaty with Sophronius. Sophronius was the great patriarch of Jerusalem. And imagine this treaty is in, you can find it in Topkapi today. Historical treaty. It's called Al-Uhd al-Umariyya, Umar Oath. Between Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Amir of Mu'mineen of the Muslims, and between Sophronius, the patriarch of Jerusalem. He said to them, as an example, part of this treaty, that all Christians are safe, nobody will touch them in their merchandise, they can live as they like. And the Christians demanded that no Jew will be allowed to enter Jerusalem from that day. Umar gave them that grant. That proves again that there were no Jews when the Muslims came. This is why I say there was no clash between Muslims and Jews ever in Jerusalem. It was between Christians and Jews since the days of Tetanus, and we mentioned the name again, before Tetanus, Titus Hadrian. Those two kings kicked all the Jews away from Jerusalem. We know in history from that day that the Muslims were treating the Jews a lot better than the Christians all over the world. It's a big myth that the Jews were there. As I mentioned about 15 minutes ago, that in the year even 1900, only 5 Jews lived in Jerusalem. They were not there. Anyhow, later on, the Jews, using the Bible, manipulated the West with Martin Luther. I'm trying to shorten the time a little bit because I talked long. And tried to manipulate the information. And they played, as we mentioned, the Bible, as we mentioned about this word about that Jacob overwhelmed God. And there is something else was also inserted in the Bible. The story maybe you know about Noah. That when Noah at his time, and this story is mentioned in the creation chapter 9 verse 18. It says that Noah, after having the harvest of grapes, he made some wine. Then he drank the wine until he came totally drunk. Then he was dancing naked. When his sons Sam and Japheth, you know, Sam is the father of the Jews and the Arabs, and Japheth was the father of the European, the Caucasians, so that they shied away. But when his son Ham saw it, he was laughing at his father. This is again inserted racism in the Bible. Why Ham? Did you ask yourself why Ham? Why Ham? Oh, his name is Ham. We call him in English, in Arabic, Ham. Because Ham was the father of the colored people. That means all of you, black, yellow, non-white people, are the sons of Ham, who is totally devious person. He's condemned. This is racism inserted in the Torah. And the Christians swallow the trick. And next day, when the father was awakened, he said, blessed is Sam, blessed is Japheth, and condemned is. Now you expect to condemn Ham. He didn't condemn Ham. He condemned his third son, Canaan. Why condemning Canaan? Noah, you are a man of God. You are a prophet of God. For sure he didn't say it, I'm sure. But the Jews are playing and manipulating the Bible. They said Noah is condemning Canaan, the third son. Okay, I made a mistake. Why condemn my third son? Because Canaan is the father of the Palestinians. Can you see? Can you relate? Can you connect? This is why America is manipulated. This is all Europe have nothing to do but to follow. Obey them. Today we can see Gaza under barbarian attack. No reply. The Palestinians have no even anti-airplanes fire. F-16, Apache, rockets from the sea, rockets from the land, tanks, UNRWA, not UNRWA, UNESCO, United Nations flags. No respect. Where this can happen anywhere else in the world? In 2009. We are in the 21st century, the century of civilization, and we see this, and the whole world is watching. For 15 consecutive days, people are killed. They are nothing. They are chicken. They are pieces of meat. Mean nothing. We saw the pictures Brother Ahmed was showing us. Every day, now we know. I know that throughout the Islamic Muslim world, people are suffering. Even in America now, studies say that people are suffering from what they see in the news. Untolerated. But it's totally tolerated by governments. Totally tolerated by the United Nations, by the Security Council. Because Canaan is condemned. Canaan is condemned. Okay, if Noah made a mistake, may Allah forbid. Does Allah make the same mistake? Now let's suppose Noah was angry and he said, condemn this Canaan. Would Allah fulfill Noah's condemnation on Canaan? He said, condemn this Canaan. Servant of servants he is to his brothers. So today when I went to one debate with some Jews, they said, Canaan is condemned. He's servant of servants. Like Ishmael, he's a son of a bound woman. He's condemned. He has no rights to inherit. Ishmael has no right to inherit. This is the manipulation of using the holy books of God Almighty to manipulate the world in the 21st century. That's what's happening. I stop from the historical part. The word Zionism, the word Zion itself, there is a mountain next to Jerusalem, is called Zion. In Arabic, it's called Sahyun. The funny thing that many Palestinians today, you can find his name is Sahyuni. Muhammad Sahyuni, Abdullah Sahyuni, because with the mountain. But the word Zion was used by Herzl, who was totally anti-religious person. The Zionist movement is not a religious movement. The people don't know that in the history even of Judaism, when the Zionist appear was totally abhorred and resisted by the Orthodox Jews. But many rabbis were killed in the process until they silenced them all. The only ones left today are the Samira Jews and the Natori Karta. Are the only Jews who are speaking against Zionism. They don't recognize the state of Israel till today because they consider it immoral, anti-Torah, because the Torah said a man cannot do nothing to bring the Messiah. You know, they are waiting for their own Messiah because they don't believe in Jesus Christ. This is the movement, the Zionist movement, and was totally adopted by the imperialist regimes of Britain and America later on. Because it, for them, it means a destruction ship in front of them in the Middle East. It's fine, good. It works for the imperialist movement. The Holocaust, I don't want to talk about it a lot. But it's performed by Palestinians, Egyptians who did the Holocaust, maybe Arabs, maybe Saudis.
Germany.
In Germany. So you revenge in Palestine. That's right. Because of the poor 6 million people, which is not proven. The world lost in the World War II, if I recall, no less than 11 million people. You mean to tell me that half of them are Jews? Jews didn't reach the amount of 6 million people even today. No, today they reached. Today they are 13 million. Imagine 1948, there were 6 million were killed. It's not historical, but we know that the Nazi regime was against the Jews and he killed many of them. It's a racist movement. Revenge from Germany, don't revenge from me. Because the Arabs were the safe havens for the Jews. You know the story, because most Filipinos, mashallah, are familiar with a little bit of Spanish history. So you know the story of, it's called the Inquisitions. The Inquisition that happened in Spain. And according to European history, they talk about that the Inquisitions was against the Jews. This was against the Muslims first. To finish any Muslims who were living in Spain that time. And the Jews were the ministers of the Muslims. They were adopted by the Muslims. So because of that, also they were harassed. But most of the Jews fled to Morocco, Tunisia, Algiers, Libya, Egypt. They are all over. In Lebanon, in Syria, till today they exist. In Yemen, in Iraq, till today you will find Jews there. So the Arab countries in the Middle East or North Africa received all the Jews and they were living happily. Until Britain made Balfour. Balfour was the foreign minister of the United Kingdom. We said, we promised the Jews that they have homeland in the country of Palestine. And they start to spread. They said, a land with no people, it gets to the people who have no land. Making a big trick or lie that Palestine was empty, which is not true. Palestine was always a civilized country and living the civilizations and lived in the 13 crusader wars, 13 movements of the crusaders, and they outlived them and lived longer. Then in 1917, the British occupied Jerusalem and the rest of Palestine, and the migrations of the Polish people, the Russian people, the American, British, French Jews, German Jews came to Palestine. Today, my brother, just I mention one fact. We have a prime minister called Yehud Olmert. We have a foreign minister called Tzip Livni. We have defense ministers called Yehud Barak. We have the president of the state called Shimon Peres. We have, alhamdulillah, a person with a brain damage called Sharon, Ariel Sharon. Still alive, but not alive. Because one of the du'as I used to make, and I know many people used to it. Oh Allah, make him suffer and ask death, and he's not granted death. And he's not granted death till today. But all of those guys I mentioned, where are the tombs of their fathers? None of them have a grave in Palestine. Just a piece of history. Yasser Arafat, from Quddua family, from Husseini family, was buried in Ramallah, while all of his chain of grandfathers in Jerusalem itself. He was banned not to be buried next to his father, next to his grandfather. Measured by that. Today we have 4 million Palestinians in diaspora all over the world. They cannot go back. And those who chose to go back, as you can see, totally surrounded by the Israelis from all borders. Palestinians have no access to the world, even to the sea. You saw, when some ships came from Westerners, even some Israelis with good-hearted people, to help the Palestinians with some medicines, were banned from entering. That's the connection between history and what's happening. And of course, the Western imperialism is part of that, and it's the main part of that, because it authenticates their purposes and goals to keep us in this diaspora forever. Time maybe doesn't allow me to show pictures. Brother Ahmed, we can co-resort back to your pictures, mashallah. I wouldn't say they are beautiful, they are ugly, but jazakallah khair, we need to see them. And that's the covering of the history of this situation. I don't want to talk about a lot about what's happening. You know, all of you are watching the news. Now a big question, what can we do? Helpless people like you and me. We are totally helpless. But inshallah we are not. My first answer, my brothers, when I see injustice, number one, I hate it. Number two, I check myself and I check my family. Am I doing something that deserves to be tortured? Maybe I am. Maybe Palestine occupied because I'm not waking up for Salat al-Fajr. I need to check myself, check my family. Are we following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are we reciting Al-Quran? Are we following that or not? So check ourselves. Let's make dua. Let's be honest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our repentance. Let's come back to Allah. The Crusaders occupied Jerusalem before for 70 years. And they slaughtered the Muslims, 70,000 Muslims were slaughtered in one day in Jerusalem. Slaughtered like sheep on the rock, the Dome of the Rock. Even this is mentioned by many historians like Gustave Le Bon and others. As you know, the people fled to the Onarwa school and they were attacked. Yesterday they hit the ambulance. They hit another bus by the Onarwa carrying fleeing people. Totally killed. No international law. No immunity. Nothing. But I'm not saying this for us to feel pain only. Pain is supposed to reproduce in a reaction. My reaction, I don't want to resort to be again a terrorist or attack any Western thing. No. My reaction, what can I do better to enhance myself and bring myself and my family toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What can I do for help if there is any door or window is open to our brothers in Palestine? They are nothing. These are nothing. These are ducks, as if you go to shoot ducks. Day and night for 24 hours bombardments. And Mr. Bush has the time to take a vacation in his ranch in Texas. And the leaders of the Arabs object. We object. May Allah forgive us all. And by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I end up by making dua. We say, Ya Allah. اللهم أنت الواحد الأحد الفرد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. اللهم إني أسألك بأنك أنت الحي القيوم الذي لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم. اللهم الطف بالمسلمين. اللهم الطف بإخواننا في غزة. اللهم انصر إخواننا في فلسطين. اللهم وحد شملهم. اللهم سدد رميتهم. اللهم تقبل شهيدهم. اللهم آوي جرحاهم. اللهم فك أسراهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم عليك باليهود الغاصبين. اللهم اجعل تدميرهم في تدبيرهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم لا ترفع لهم راية. اللهم لا تحقق لهم غاية. اللهم اجعلهم لمن بعدهم آية. اللهم أريتنا ما فعلت بفرعون وما فعلت بعاد وثمود. اللهم أرنا فيهم آياتك يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم اجمعنا على طاعة كتاب الله وعلى حب سنة رسول الله. اللهم اجعلنا من عبادك المخلصين الخالصين الداعين لدين الله العاملين في دين الله. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وآله وسلم. وجزاكم الله خير. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.